jumped so high, I touched the clouds. Whoa, oh, oh.
Good morning. You're listening to Hanson Sports Talk Radio, partner with Apple USA Radio. This is your host, Christian Hanson. We have a lot of sports to cover this morning, but first, here's a quick message from our local sponsor. Have you ever thought about a career in broadcasting? The Illinois Center for Broadcasting can get you started. The exciting field of television radio at ICB. Instructors are currently working in the broadcasting industry with training on the latest digital audio and video equipment. And once you finish your time at ICB, you'll get the full-time support of the job placement department that will help you find your first job. Just think about it. You'll be working at a TV or radio station in less than a year. So pick up the phone and call ICB today for more information at 630-916-1700. That's 630-916-1700. The Illinois Center for Broadcasting, where broadcasting careers begin. Alright guys, welcome to Babbel USA Radio. This is the Morning Rush, presented by Babbel. I'm your host, Christian Hansen. Last night we had two games going on in the playoffs. We had ALCS Game 4 and NLCS Game 4 as well. We're going to recap both of those games, and we're going to move over to the hottest team right now in baseball, in the Kansas City Royals. Let's head over there. The Royals sweep the Orioles, obviously, to earn a shot at the crown. And Kansas City is headed to the World Series for the first time since 1985. That's nearly three decades. And, you know, the Royals are now returning to the World Series. I mean, this unlikely, undaunted, unstoppable club from Kansas City finished off the Baltimore Orioles in four straight games, sweeping the American League Championship Series with a 2-1 victory last night at Kauffman Stadium. With a blue-hued throng of 40,000-plus fans roaring on a sunny 65-degree afternoon, the Royals struck for two runs in the first inning with an infield single, a hit-by-pitch, a sacrifice bunt, and a fielder's choice capped by Alcides Escobar's kicking the ball out of the catcher's glove on a play at the plate, clearing the way for a second run to score. It was all they would need to win the game and move on to the World Series. But defense again played a leading role with left fielder Alex Gordon, who pounded in the left wall as he made one of the several flying catches. Winning pitcher Jason Vargas worked through the first 5 2/3 innings with a tight fist of bullpen, you know, finishing up with scoreless work. And then Lorenzo came in, you know, who had 5-38, 8-15. He scored five runs and made several outstanding catches and was named MVP of the ALCS. And there was no doubt how owner David Glass felt as he stood upon the temporary victory stage on the infield. And, you know, he accepted the American League trophy in front of the roaring throng of fans at Kauffman Stadium last night. When he was presented the trophy, he told the fans, you know, we dedicate this trophy to all these fans. Around him, the Royals celebrated the record-tying eighth straight postseason victory. Every game they've played to join the 1980 and 85 teams as World Series contestants. They'll meet the National League champions, either St. Louis or San Francisco, beginning next Tuesday night in Kansas City. Kauffman Stadium's infield became a festive knot of players, coaches, front office personnel, and owner and other Royals folks pulling on caps that read league champions and t-shirts emblazoned with "We Own the Pennant." Billy Butler had this to say in the midst of the celebration. You know, we're the best team in baseball through the second half of the last year, and we basically were this year too. And we got a roll. We got on a roll at the right time. We're basically playing our best baseball. I think we're showing everybody in the world what kind of talent we have in here. And now fans across the country and world are learning about the little-known, underrated Midwest teams called the Royals. Just a few years ago, people in Kansas City knew they had a baseball team. That's how bad they were. But if you look at how the Royals won the game, Escobar limped painfully after taking a foul off his left foot in the first inning. But when he bounced a ball over Miguel Gonzalez, he streaked into an outfield hit at a full gate. Nori Akoi was hit by a pitch, and Lorenzo Cain, bunting on his own, moved the runners over. And it was Eric Hosmeyer's grounder who was fielded by first baseman Steven Pierce, who threw home, only to have the ball kicked out of catcher Caleb Joseph's gloves by sliding Escobar. The ball shot toward the backstop, allowing Aoki to score, and it was 2-0. After Vargas got through his five-plus innings, the backing boys of the bullpen took over. It was all working for the second straight day. Calvin Herrera got 5 outs, working in both the 6th and 7th innings. Empty tank? No chance. Wade Davis added a scoreless 8th, and a Greg Holland notched his 9th for a 6th save of the postseason and 4th of the series, something only Dennis Eckersley in the 1988 A's and John Wetland of the 1996 Yankees have done in a 7-game series. So you know what, we'll see. Ever since that wild card game against Oakland where they were down, I believe the score was 7-3. They came back, ended up winning that game in dramatic fashion. It was an unbelievable game, but we'll see if this Royals team could do. Both the Giants and the Cardinals are right up there too with the hottest team in baseball, but if the Giants win, obviously I want them to win the World Series. I'm a huge Giants fan. But if the Cardinals win, Kansas City better be prepared because this is a team with more experience, a lot more depth, a lot more there's a lot of veterans on that team. And their head coach, Mike Bethany, I believe even played in a World Series. So, they kind of have that chemistry throughout that locker room. And to be honest with you, they've been in the NLCS for the past 4 years. So, and this is a whole new experience for Kansas City. This is their first time making it into the World Series since 85. We'll see what happens. But moving over the Cardinals and Giants game last night, the Giants came out with a huge win at AT&T Park last night by the Bay, winning 6-4 over the St. Louis Cardinals. They rode that 6-inning rally to a 3-1 NLCS edge. I believe they play tonight, and they win. They're moving on to the World Series for the third time in the last 4 years. Ryan Vogelsong called it Giants karma. Pablo Sandoval reverted to as the small game. By any term, the force that drove the Giants to their 6-4 victory over the St. Louis Cardinals on Wednesday night, Game 5 of the National League Championship Series, materialized in the 6th inning. That's when the Giants vaulted ahead with 3 runs, combining opportunistic offense with St. Louis defensive lapses. The Giants lead the series now 3-1 and could clutch the 3rd trip to the World Series in 5 seasons by defeating the Cardinals in Thursday night's Game 5 at AT&T Park. The Giants won the series in 10 and 12. And, another good thing for the Giants fans is the Giants are always successful on even years. If you look when they won the World Series in 2010, it's obviously an even number, 2010. They won it in 2012, even number. Now 14, we're here at even number again. Hopefully that streak continues alive and we can bring another World Series trophy back to the Bay Area. But anyway, San Francisco continued its postseason pattern by scoring twice in that 6th inning without benefit of hits. Buster Posey drove in the other run with a second 2-out single of the evening that completed a 3-RBI output. The Giants haven't homered in 135 at-bats during the NLCS, and they've even mustered just 2 homers all postseason. Moreover, they amazed 12 of the 22 runs they scored in their last 6 postseason games when the batter did not record a hit. But if you look at how the Giants won, the Giants trailed 4-3 as pinch hitter Juan Perez began their big 6th by drawing a leadoff walk from left-hander Marco Gonzalez. Then it was Brandon Crawford, a left-handed batter who defied the percentages by hitting .320 off lefties in the regular season, who lashed a single. After pinch hitter Matt Duffy's sacrifice bunt advanced the runners, Gregor Blanco tapped a grounder toward first baseman Matt Adams, who charged the ball aggressively but short-hopped his throw home. Catcher Tony Cruz never had control of the ball as Perez slid head-first with the tying run. Joe Panic hit another grounder to Adams, who stepped on the bag for the inning 2nd out, but Adams never checked Crawford, the runner on 3rd. He didn't break for the plate until Adams threw wide to 2nd in an attempt to retire Blanco. Right-hander Seth Maness relieved Gonzalez and forged ahead on the count to Posey 0-2. Unruffled, Posey lined the next pitch in the left center field to score Blanco. That was a huge win for the Giants, and hopefully they get it done tonight and move on to the World Series for the 3rd time in the last 4 years. That'd be unbelievable. The word dynasty could be in the mix if that happens. and definitely will be in the mix if they win the series this year. But that was Valve USA Radio's MLB wraparound. We're going to take a short break, and once you get back, we're going to be more sports. You're listening to Valve Sports Talk Radio, The Morning Rush. Christian Anson, your host. From the first drop to the last stop, stick with the taste that's just right for hockey night. From start to finish, Bud Light's superior drinkability means it's not too heavy, not too light, and the easy-to-drink taste won't fill you up when you're enjoying that one game that never slows down. Bud Light, the difference is drinkability. Real cheddar flavor at full strength. Nothing beats the bold flavor of Merck's, made with 100% real aged Wisconsin cheddar. Slap it on pretzels, burgers, chili, and more. Welcome back. You're listening to Vavel Sports Talk Radio. This is The Morning Rush. The Morning Rush is presented by AT&T. AT&T, the nation's fastest and now most reliable 4G LTE network. We're going to get to looking at how Kevin Durant's injury affects the betting lines for sports bettors in Vegas this year. It's quite surprising, but when the news broke Sunday morning about Kevin Durant's right foot injury, the NBA suffered a big blow. The stress fracture, which the reigning league MVP has yet to determine how to treat, is expected to sideline the OKC Thunder star for 6 to 8 weeks, but pro basketball isn't the only industry affected by Durant's impending absence. Sports wagering has also been significant changes due to the five-time All-Stars injury, but thanks to MyTopSportsbooks.com, fans can see exactly how much impact Durant's undetermined status has changed odds on a number of bets. For instance, prior to Sunday's news, Durant was a 11-4 favorite to win a second straight Most Valuable Player award. Now he's a 30-1 shot. Conversely, dynamic teammate Russell Westbrook was 40-1 long shot to earn MVP honors. But the three-time All-Star is now 14-1 shot, and the over-under bet on OKC's win total went from 57.5 to 54 after the news broke. We're no experts, but the over still looks like a solid bet, and how the value for Westbrook's investors looked, I mean, we'll see. Oklahoma City tips off the regular season October 29th at Portland. Hopefully, he gets better soon. You don't like to see a guy like Kevin Durant get injured, especially someone, he's a well-respected athlete, humble. He's just a great guy. I don't like seeing things happen like that to anyone, but especially people like Kevin Durant. Now we're going to move over to the Blackhawks hockey. Jonas Hiller last night had a huge game in net. For the Flames, he saved 49 shots and helped the Flames edge the Blackhawks in OT. This was the story. Chicago Blackhawks dominated Calgary Flames last night, but it wasn't enough to beat goalie Jonas Hiller on the fortitude of his teammates. Despite being outshot 50-18 at the United Center, the Flames won for the second time in as many nights by riding Hiller's 49 save effort to a 2-1 overtime victory that ended 25 seconds short of a shootout on Saturday, Michael Backlund's goal. It was the first time the Flames won a game in which they allowed 50-plus shots since Game 1 of the 2004 Western Conference Final, when they were victorious despite being outshot 52-37. But, you know, by nearly every measure but the power play success and final score, the Blackhawks 2-0-1 now controlled this game, including misses, 16 and blocked shots with 30. They launched 96 shot attempts to 33 for the Flames, who are 3-2-0 as of now. Calgary also handed the Blackhawks multiple opportunities to seize control by continually committing penalties that led to power plays. One of the Blackhawks' seven-man advantage situations was converted into a goal, and that one scored by center Andrew Shaw at the 11:14:15 to the third to tie it 1-1. But, you know, they needed a video review to see if a stick touched the puck above the crossbar. Replays were inconclusive and the goal stood, but not even that doused the Flames' effort. They withstood more pressure from the Blackhawks in the waiting moments of the regulation, and they found new life in overtime, forcing goalie Corey Crawford to make 16 saves to make a couple of great stops before Backlund ended it with a wrist shot from the top of the left circle. It rewarded Hiller with his first victory as a member of the Flames after signing with them as a free agent this past offseason. Before this year, he was over in Anaheim. But coming into the game, he was 0-2-0 in his first two starts with a 3.53 goals against average and a 0.901 save percentage. But Hiller became the third goalie in Flames history to face 15 more shots and allow one goal, joining Fred Brathwaite and Andrei Trelefov. They might want to cut back on the penalties, though. All seven the Flames committed resulted in power plays, which forced Hiller and the penalty killers in front of him to work hard for much of the game. Each successful kill, however, they did struggle to kill the penalties in the first three games. On the flip side, the Blackhawks have to be disappointed despite the point earned. But after dropping two games in overtime to the Flames last season, it happened again in a very unlikely fashion. They had multiple opportunities to score goals and take a comfortable lead, but each one fizzled. Even Carbaum, Daniel Carcillo's squadron, had a couple of opportunities in the first and third, following nice feeds off the rush. He failed to collect a puck each time with wide openings in the net. But he wasn't alone. For Brian Bickle, couldn't get a stick on a nice pass from traffic in the second, right in front of the crease. And, you know, he watched the puck glide harmlessly through the traffic. And then even Patrick Kane had a good chance spoiled during a 2-on-1 in the second with his wrist shot sailing wide to keep the game scoreless. But, you know, it went like most of the night for Chicago, you know, which gets its chance to make amends Saturday at home against the Predators, which hopefully they turn things around and get that win, because last night's loss was a joke. But defenseman Dennis Wadman broke that scoreless tie last night at 11:55 of the second with his first goal, firing a point shot off the clean faceoff win by Joe Colburn that appeared to clip rookie defenseman Trevor Van Riemsdyk. His brother James Van Riemsdyk, I believe, plays for Toronto. But anyway, Trevor Van Riemsdyk in the low slot and zip past Crawford. But it was the fifth shot of the game for the Flames, who trailed in that category by an 18-2 count after the first period, 30-3 with 9 minutes left in the second, and 34-8 after 40 minutes. We'll see. Last night's loss was disappointing, but like I said, Daniel Carcillo had a hell of a game despite coming up short without converting on that goal. He's been looking better for these first three games, and I'm really happy. Hopefully we got our stuff together. We'll see. But yeah, we're going to take another little break. Once you get back, you're going to be listening to more of Avalo Sports Talk Radio. This is The Morning Rush, presented by Christian Hansen. Hi, welcome back to the Morning Rush presented by Valley USA Radio. This is your host, Christian Hansen. NBA 2K15, your time has come. Pick up NBA 2K15 now. And it's at your local stores, whether it be Target, Best Buy, Walmart, or more. Pick it up now. NBA 2K15, your time has come. On PS4, PS3, Xbox One, and Xbox 360. Pick it up today. Your time has come. Welcome back to Vavil Sports Talk Radio. This is the Morning Rush. Before we went to the break, we were talking about the NHL and the Blackhawks. The Blackhawks lost last night to Calgary. But we're moving on to the Chicago Bulls basketball and previewing their upcoming 14-15 season. Right now, the Bulls are title contenders with one big if: the health of Derrick Rose. But in 2013-14, for the second consecutive season, Rose went down with a season-ending knee injury. For the second consecutive season, the Bulls' title hopes were dashed. But Rose had played 10 games in the last two seasons. He appears to go for the 2014-15 campaign, thanks in large part to his participation for Team USA and the gold-winning romp at the summer's FIBA World Cup in Spain. But Rose's experience in Spain with Team USA wasn't always positive. He struggled badly shooting the basketball, but for Rose, it was more like an extended training camp. His conditioning is fine, and Rose is ready for the regular season. Chicago is once again considered one of the league's elite. Rose is a former MVP, and the Bulls, with him at the helm, finished with the best record in the Eastern Conference twice. So thanks in large part to the efforts of Joakim Noah, a ferocious defense and genius head coach, and Tom Thibodeau, the Bulls made the playoffs both seasons. Rose was a non-factor. But last season they lost in the first round of the Washington Wizards, so change was needed. It starts with Rose, but the Bulls enjoyed a nice offseason in retooling their roster. They won the sweepstakes of Pau Gasol, one of the best big men available in the free agency. He spurned the San Antonio Spurs and Oklahoma City Thunders, among others, to replace Carlos Boozer, who's now headed to LA, and Boozer, who was amnestized by the team in the offseason to free up space to bring over Mirotic. But the Bulls also improved thanks, like I said, to the arrival of Mirotic, a decorated international star. The Spanish Montenegrin big man is skilled and should fit right in with Chicago. The Bulls also pulled off a draft night trade to acquire Dougie McBuckets, also known as Doug McDermott, the sharpshooter from Creighton, who could provide much-needed help in long-range shooting for a Bulls team that finished 24th in three-point percentage last season. But those were both nice bench moves, but the NBA in 2014 is a star-driven league. Rose is a star star when healthy. Gasol is close to that level. The man who really emerged to a different stratosphere is Noah. Last season, Noah won the Defensive Player of the Year award and was the first team All-NBA center. But, the Bulls will have no choice to live it under Thibodeau. He demands excellence, especially on the defensive end. Chicago is littered with great, dependable veterans. You got guys like Taj Gibson, Jimmy Butler, Mike Dunleavy, Aaron Brooks, Nazi Muhammad, and Kirk Heinrich. And Tibbs will have to figure a way to slide Mirotic and McDermott into that rotation, but it's a nice luxury to have. The roster is loaded. They have stars this season. The Bulls just have to keep them healthy. I mean, if you look at last year's results, like they went 48-34, finished second in the Central, and lost in the Eastern Conference quarterfinals to Washington. If you look at their additions, they added, like I said, Pau Gasol, Doug McDermott, Nikola Mirotic, Aaron Brooks, and Etuan Moore. And the projected lineup right now is, you got Derrick Rose at the one, Jimmy Butler at the two, Dunleavy at the three, Gasol at the 4, and Noah at the 5. And if you look at their bench, it's stacked. I mean, you got Taj Gibson, Nikola Mirotic, Kirk Heinrich, Nazi Muhammad, Tony Snell, Aaron Brooks, Dougie McBuckets. The front court, if you look at it like this, Noah posted career highs, 12.6 points per game, 11.3 rebounds per game, and 5.4 assists per game. That last number, the assist really separated Noah from most of the other centers in the league. But Noah was known primarily as a defensive player, but last season Thibodeau ran the offense through him and his exceptionally passing ability. Defensively, Noah has no peer. He can defend quicker bigs on the perimeter and isn't afraid to bang in the interior. Noah is maybe the toughest player in the league. He yields nothing. But Noah is also a sensational leader. It's not all about the rah-rah stuff, which Noah has always seemed doing plenty, but the mindset he brings. Noah is a rock for this team, and is... He's been unbelievable these past few years. But Gasol's production declined under Lakers coach Mike D'Antoni. Gasol wasn't a good fit in that high-octane system, but he did average 17.4 points per game and 9.7 rebounds per game. He has plenty left in the tank offensively, but we just don't know how much. But Gasol is not a good defender. That might be a problem for Thibodeau. Gibson could see fourth quarter minutes since he's Tibbs' stress at this moment. But Gasol will give the Bulls a low post presence they haven't had since Boozer first came to the Windy City back in 2010. And I mean, he's a legitimate scoring option to Rose, and that's something the Bulls haven't had either. Dunleavy was a nice fit in Chicago during the regular season. He started 61 games, averaging 11.3 points per game, and shot 38% from long range, which was, I mean, a four-year low, but Dunleavy's numbers improved during the postseason, and he's not on fleet foot. You know, he's savvy and a good fit for Thibodeau. I mean, and then you look at their backcourt. A healthy Rose is a force. Did you remember that? I mean, his last full season in the NBA, he averaged 21.8 points per game, 7.9 assists, shot 44% from the field, and 31% from three-point range. He looked tentative last season. There was no way to say it, but Rose did score 20-plus in two of his final home games before he tore his right meniscus. Rose has had a surgery and was gone again, but since our most recent memory of Rose was in Barcelona, his averages are not astounding. He averaged 4.8 points per game, 3.1 assists per game. He shot 35% from the field and a depressing 1-for-19 from three-point range. Again, it's not too big a reason to push the panic button since Rose was basically getting his condition back, but based on last season's poor start, the Bulls will be very mindful of how Rose looks early. But, you know, we'll see. With a healthy Rose, the Bulls are certainly Eastern Conference title contenders and probably NBA championship contenders. But this is how I look at it. The Bulls will be in good hands, good terms, if Derek stays healthy for at least 70 games. You know, if he could play at least 70 games, the Bulls will be in good shape. We'll just have to see how it works out. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it. See what happens. But, man. But we're going to play an interview. I was with Derrick Rose at the Team USA versus Brazil training sessions in Chicago, Illinois this past August.
We got a long way to go, and we just happy to be here and happy to be back in Chicago this year.
All right, well, tell me about your game. How do you feel about your game at this point?
I think my game is coming along pretty good. Again, the rhythm, I didn't have any turnovers today, so that's a good thing. And just trying to stay the same, stay consistent with my workouts, and just trying to stay consistent with shooting the ball.
Yeah, Derek, can you feel the vibe in this city, not only here over the last 24, 48 hours since USA arrived, but also the Bulls fans anticipating the top of season ahead?
Oh, yeah, it's been crazy here in Chicago the last couple of days. Everybody's been asking for tickets. I think the arena is going to be sold out tomorrow just because of Bulls fans. They want to see some basketball, and all these great guys got fans coming. So I think that just being in the arena and just being in the atmosphere is going to bring some excitement to the city and bring some excitement to the guys because we haven't played in front of a packed crowd. I mean, I know I haven't, but it's going to be a packed crowd, and I know it should be fun for the city.
All right, upcoming regular season for the Bulls, 2014-15. Off-season
moves. That's just a snippet of my encounter with Derrick Rose at the training sessions in Chicago, Illinois. But that's going to do it today for the Morning Rush. You're listening to Vavil Sports Talk Radio. This is your host, Christian Hansen. One last added before we go, Benny's Beverage Depot. If you can't find it at Benny's, it's probably not worth drinking. Thank you for listening to Vavil Sports Talk Radio, the Morning Rush. Have a good one, everyone.